Todd, you really want to talk about the concert first?
Oh, I've heard wonderful things.
What did you hear about this? So I went to the Grimes concert the other day. It was Friday.
Okay.
Grimes concert at the Electric Factory, and I guess Dan, his girlfriend, and his roommate were going.
Well, and I didn't realize that Grimes is that song we always listen to before the show.
It's the pre-show song.
Yeah. I didn't know that until like Dan pointed that out to me. I was like, oh. But I heard he was Captain the Fun Vacuum.
First off, I had a really good spot upstairs at the bar where I could sit.
So it's electronic dance music that you're supposed to get up and dance to. Jared was like, yeah, I got cool seats up here, and I don't want to move.
He's probably the only one not on drugs that night,
too. And he had like a glass of water with him.
I didn't even get a glass of water. I didn't drink anything. Nothing. So Dan's like, do you want to come down and be in the crowd with all these people? And I'm like, no. And then I did because I'm like, I'm going to try something new. And I went in. And what did you hear about that?
Ah, he was miserable.
It wasn't.
People were like dancing and bumping into his hair, and he was all miserable.
No.
And I saw pictures, and it was like, he's like.
No. What happened is I was cool. We were there like 20 minutes before she goes on. 20 minutes before she goes on, we get our spot. And then out of nowhere, these random people just start pushing you out of trying to get by.
It's a concert, dude.
No, man. I'm like, where are you going to go? But my friend is over there. I'm like, fuck your friend. To some 12-year-old.
She wasn't 12.
No, but I'm standing in a spot, and I got Dan and Dan's wife and Dan's roommate.
The unicorn?
And we're standing there, and these people try to force by, and it's like, you have nowhere to go. And they ended up one person ahead. I'm like, but now you're just blocking her view because you're tall.
I should just go watch it from the pit.
Keep in mind, everyone behind you, you're blocking with your giant afro.
But I already had my spot. I owned it. Anyway, move on. Let me do my intro. But I tried, Todd.
What show did I bring you to? Fun?
Fun was awesome.
You hated it.
What are you talking about?
You sat there the whole time.
And then Jared
texted
me later on, like,
you wanted to leave early.
I was out drinking with Joffy and this other guy. And he's like, why didn't you invite me? That's exactly why I didn't invite you, because you're a fun vacuum. We're all sitting there getting hammered, and Jared's going to sit there and look at his water and be like, do you want to go get sushi? Do you want to get sushi?
Want to go to La Colombe?
Like, no, I want to get shit-faced and have fun.
Way to make fun of me. Thank you.
You're welcome.
I'm not that bad. I have fun.
We're in Germany. We'll see how fun you are.
Yeah. Jared Poland, FronosPhoto.com. Welcome to Raw Talk, episode number 186.
Wow.
This is my intro. We have an action-packed show this week, and you better enjoy this week's show because there is none next week.
Yeah.
Because Steven's traveling.
Asshole.
I'll be at Firefly, yep.
He's taking a vacation.
Douchebag.
It's part of his vacation package.
I'll have fun there.
Does he get paid vacation?
Damn right.
Yeah.
Does he?
Why wouldn't he?
Man, I mean, it's just Steven. I mean,
we have, he can take off as many days of the week as he wants, as long as
Noah
his work
get paid
gets
vacation?
Done.
I never
will
take
Noah
off,
get paid
ever.
Vacation?
I do one Noah, week a year, and that's it.
It will be the same. So, Noah, did you sign the contract yet? Yeah, exactly.
Huh?
So, Noah's coming full time. Yeah, that's right. We have an
NDA. I don't want you
I'm
talking
sure you
about
do.
My junk in front of other people.
We have an NDA. So, there will be no show next week because. We had an option of making this like, let's do two halves and
make it unique.
But we just figured we'll do one full-on show, which is what we have here.
Yep.
And then next week, we won't have a show. It's the summer, so there's a lot of that happening. We are traveling. I'm traveling the week after, and then Todd is traveling to the same place that I'll be in, but not at the same time.
I mean,
which horrified my daughter, by the way. I was like, yeah, guess who's going to be in Anaheim near Disneyland when I'm there? She's like, oh, who? Jared. Oh, no, Daddy! I know Mr. Jared!
Considering that we're all taking vacations back-to-back for like 3 weeks in a row, and we're only missing one show, I still think that's really good.
Yeah, it's not bad.
Yeah, sure. Not bad at all.
So we've got that happening. Germany is booked. We'll be going to Photokina in Cologne. Todd's actually going. I don't know if his passport comes in.
I went and did it the other day. I went at 8 a.m. at the post office. First person in line. I walked out in like 10 minutes.
Wait, you didn't get your passport? I've never had a passport. Really?
Yeah. It said 4 weeks. So.
Oh, wow. Yeah.
So he'll get his...
I thought I was late on getting mine.
I can't wait till they flag his picture.
Oh, it's a terrible picture. I have a copy of it.
You can't smile, right?
Can we pop
like
it up?
Yeah, I gotta take a picture of
could
it.
Could you smile?
You can do whatever you
want
in your picture.
But they made me like tilt my glasses
for no reflection.
And then I was like, and then the flash was bright, and I went like that, and I look high.
Do you look like Noah?
They usually don't let you do a flash.
Kinda
interesting.
Well, no, you do a flash. They do flash.
They took a picture at the post office.
Yeah.
That's terrible.
It's not professional or anything.
Not at all.
It's some disgruntled employee.
Hating their life. She was sweet. She was a nice lady.
Anyway, so Photokina is going to happen, and then we're going to go. We usually go to another place after, and we're going to go to Berlin. Cool. So we're going to try and at least set up meetups there, just where we go and hang out, and I can be a fun vacuum in Germany.
Yes.
Yeah, fun vacuum.
The fun vacuum tour.
The what?
The fun vacuum tour.
So I can we can do that. We may do a raw talk somewhere. We still have to figure that out.
That'll be rough
if it's
to
in
travel
Cologne.
That
we're
going to
do a fountain crawl, drink water at every place.
Can't
no,
wait.
No, we're going to have Kolsch, of which I'll have none. I'll have Bavarian pretzels. But we could just go to Frankfurt Hall and do that.
Exactly.
That's true.
Joe, how many hot dogs did you sell on Dollar Dog Night?
Oh, yeah. 800.
Shut the front door.
Oh, my God.
You didn't sell 800 hot dogs.
That's a lot of freaking hot dogs. The time before
that, I saw nobody can hear you, Joe.
That's like Steven on a Saturday night.
Did you bring your microphone again?
Yeah. Get out! Get the fuck out! Get the fuck
Anyway,
You make good commission.
Let's talk about the interview.
It's awesome.
That we have coming up. We have Alex Cooper's coming on.
Cool.
She's a girl I met.
Alice Cooper?
Not Alice
Welcome
Cooper.
Welcome to my nightmare?
No.
Scared me as a
School's
child.
School's out?
No. Met her. She was shadowing Dave Leno at one of these one of the soccer games I was at. And
how do you shadow Dave Leno?
Well, you watch what he's doing.
I guess.
Just watch him? I would sit and imitate him.
What would that sound like?
Oh, it would sound kind of like this.
This pretentious douchebag moment is brought to you by
Jared's Fun Vacuum.
I love when you were Snapchatting Dave at the recent game you went to, I think when he brought the 1DX Mark II.
Yeah.
He's all like energetic and like, hi, Snapchatters. And he keeps talking.
He's the best. He's a pro, man.
And
he kept
talking, like doing a whole spiel. And
he's
you're
like,
it's 10 seconds.
Dave Leno. I come here often. And I like to call games. Yeah, it's a great day out here at the park at, what's it called? Talon Energy Stadium here,
gearing up
for a game between your Philadelphia Union.
He's awesome.
He's really good.
If you watch the editing guide footage, he's such a pro. He'll start talking. Be like, hold on, 3, 2,
always
one.
Does that.
And I'm like, holy
he always
Jesus!
Does that. Three,
I was like,
two,
I was
one.
Honestly, I was like, I don't even think I need to be here.
Yeah,
like, he's got this.
That's because he's
a
pro.
He just gets into character.
He's
three,
awesome.
Two.
All right,
one.
Let me get back to the Alex. Why we had Alex on is she has an interest in starting a YouTube channel, being a content creator, and going that direction. And I thought this would be really good, just like when we had Matt Beck on. Just like when we had Noah on, these are awesome brain dumps that should trigger ideas in people's minds out there that could utilize it to be successful out into the world.
By the way, update on Matt Beck. Is he still cranking out videos?
Yeah, Matt Beck is cranking out videos. Whew. Yeah, nonstop.
He still has that giant glowing wheel too, doesn't he?
Well, he's copied.
Like the wheel of Fro.
He's copied everything that we do.
Lighter.
And it works.
And it works well.
That's
he
awesome.
Got to the same wheel.
Better.
But
it's probably better, actually.
So anyway, shut up, Todd.
What's his number?
Todd,
CBD's
look at your
color commentary.
Todd, let's do a close-up of your new glasses. Do mine reflect blue also?
No, his reflect purple. Yours reflect blue.
That's because he didn't get the good ones.
I had a long conversation to the lady about like just
oh
different
my God,
brands
it looks like
do different
tinted
like,
purple
colors.
From here.
Well, didn't
weird.
Well, who makes yours?
Best of the best with honors. The glasses or the covering.
Didn't you get Hoya lenses or something?
Zeiss.
Oh, you have Zeiss glass.
Even better.
Sure, it is
best of the best.
Mine have Crizal and they're extra sharp.
Mine
and
have Moet. So.
The first thing I thought when I saw Todd's new glasses was the warden from Shawshank Redemption, because that's what he looks like.
The dude who blew
Dufresne.
What's he look like?
Looks like you.
I gotta look at him. These are my conservative ones.
They match your haircut very well.
These are the conservative glasses that I got.
Really?
These are the ones I'll wear to PTA meetings. The cool ones I'm picking up later.
Bring them up next week.
They are amazing, and I'm not going to.
And you got
the
sunglasses too. And
yeah, my sunglasses are straight Top Gun aviators.
All right, let's get into the Pluggy McPluggerson part.
Yes.
Australia.
Hold on, Dave.
And here's this week's plug. Let's say something inappropriate and lose another sponsor.
Thanks, Dave.
Thank you, Dave.
We're not. There's nothing inappropriate. I don't know that we could say anything inappropriate that would get Rode in trouble.
Bindi Irwin?
Bindi Irwin?
Give me a minute.
Dirigeridoo? So Rode is announcing that they're coming out with a dirigeridoo.
They're tight.
They're not actually coming out with a dirigeridoo. But they want to bring us to Australia. And if you want us to go to Australia because Rode will bring it, we want to actually go to their factory and do some raw talks throughout Australia when we're there.
Sick.
And maybe pet a koala bear. Go to on Twitter, make sure it's, hey, at Rode. Oi. At Rode Mics. hashtag bring the fro. And then you could add like to Australia or something.
We can be hangaroos and hang out with one another.
That was terrible.
Go screw yourself.
Knife. Anyway, the actual plug part is that if you still want to enter the My Road Reel competition, you can't. It's over.
Yeah.
But you can go to myroadreel.com and you can vote for your favorite film, which is great. There's so many up there.
I wonder how many entries I got this year.
If you entered, let us know that you entered. Send us your entries because maybe we'll feature a Fro featured entry. So maybe you got, that we should do that. Make sure that you send, if they entered, they can send an email to the meme email.
Sure.
What's that again?
Singwheelfro@gmail.com.
If you entered the My Road Reel competition and you did that, maybe we'll help you get a Fro bump and sign and get more votes if we like it. If it sucks, we're not going to promote it.
If it sucks, it's not,
If it's good, maybe
we'll
make
fun of you.
We'll feature it on the show and then we'll put a link so you can hopefully get, maybe we'll just do that. Maybe we'll feature, we're starting a newsletter in the email, an email newsletter. Maybe we'll feature you as the Fro reader.
Somebody spell check it?
Yes,
Noah's
please.
Writing it.
Please.
Noah's writing it.
I'm
not writing it.
God.
Everything that's misspelled is always Jared. Every single time.
Don't know how to spell. What can I say? It's Council Rock Education at its finest.
By the way, I'm not looking forward to that flight
at
to
its
Australia.
Findest? At
that's
its finest or finest?
Finest.
Findest?
I didn't say findest.
It was. You meant to say find last week and you put fine in the YouTube video?
Was that for Raw Talk?
Yes.
Yeah, what was it exactly?
Something about something I find.
The first like find. 10 comments.
Yeah.
By the way, I had to go back and change the title on the website because you only fixed the title on YouTube. You didn't fix it on the website. I had to fix it everywhere else.
What'd you do? Copy and paste your misspelling?
That's what yes. It does.
Yeah, it's the three places. Did you fix it on the podcast?
I didn't fix it on Libsyn, so it's probably still.
It's probably still there.
I don't put the titles in.
Anyway, so back to the road plug.
Yes.
Vote of the, voter of the week will win a Rode Video Micro.
What?
That's the one you use, right, all the time?
The Video Micro or Video Mic Me?
Me, I think you use.
I use one of the mics, but
I always get confused which one.
Chance to win something there, so that is perfectly awesome. But if you guys want us to come to Australia and you're one of our Aussie listeners, please don't take offense to my Bindi Irwin or anything. Maybe she'll come out to the show and I can interview Bindi Irwin.
Oh, God.
Hi, I'm Bindi Irwin. My brother's name is Bobby Irwin.
It'd be the worst interview ever.
Hashtag, oi.
Screw you, Jerry, you're an asshole.
Oi,
leave me I'll show my you quarters enough. Alone. I'll have a quarter to bite your jugular.
Oi, at Road Mics, bring Fro to Australia. Send them if you want us to come there. And that is the end of that.
You going to fly first class?
Nope.
I have a
Joe
lot of
goes in under with the baggage.
He goes baggage.
Steerage.
We check him in with the think tank bag.
Noah has to fucking swim.
Oh, we'll bring the production manager 50.
If we do go to Australia, I'm going to see if I can use points to upgrade to at least the business class.
You
so
definitely
I can lay
have
down
points.
I have 400,000 points right now.
Okay.
And I looked at flights to Australia. Oh, I forgot to mention, if you see other two people on the side, we've got Furno here, and we've got Alex over there. So I've qualified them if you're wondering who the people are sitting over there.
Doesn't
live audience.
People are going to still come in. Who's in the corner?
I know. Every time.
It usually does happen.
That's usually me, though.
I looked it up. It would maybe cost me about 120 miles to do round trip to Australia right now.
Oh, look at
which
you.
Is pretty. And then I looked up Tokyo for when I. If you're a Tokyo listener, please leave a comment because I may just one day show up in Tokyo and need somebody to take me around.
Random.
To go find sushi. Seriously.
Let's just go to Tokyo.
That.
Will you rent a Porsche when we get to Australia?
Damn right.
Why would I rent a Porsche?
Only the best.
Okay, so video podcast. Don't forget, you can go to iTunes or anywhere that you can find podcasts and type in Raw Talk and look for the yellow logo one. You've got that. Alan's Cannonball. This is the last time we are plugging it because it's on June 18th, which is Saturday, starting at 10 to 4. The taco truck is official.
What?
The taco truck is official.
I'm
it
jealous.
Will be there.
That's awesome.
So taco truck will be there.
Oh, my God.
I'll be there. Can they see that? Joe, can you pick that up?
Yeah, they'll probably see
Joe,
it.
Joe, pick
GoPro
that up over your head right there. That big thing. Pick it up over
Joe,
your head.
Joe, pick it
bench
up.
Press.
And then bring
bench
it closer
press
to
it.
The center.
You can't pick it up, can you? Oh, his face is getting red. Just stand there the rest of the show.
Yeah, hold
just,
it.
No, stay. Don't move.
Don't move.
Don't move.
This is a Pixima Pro
so
10
messed up.
That Canon sent to me so that we can give it away. Somebody... Somebody is going to go home from the from that event. You have a great opportunity to win this for free. All right, you can put it down.
I know.
He's like, is it that heavy, Joe? How much weight is on it?
It's like any arms for sure.
What's the label say?
55 pounds.
Whoa.
That's more than the Stanley Cup.
Look at those guns.
I kind of want to try lifting it.
He looks bigger than Jared today.
I want to try lifting it, though.
Oh, here we go.
I want you to take your shirt off while you're at it.
There's a girl here. Let me pick it up. Next's shirt's coming off soon.
Yeah.
We'll wait till my pants come off. No, I don't think I
want to. Well, we do have a guy here, too, so that makes sense.
Well, I could lay down. No, I don't want to put it. It's like the Stanley Cup. All right.
Nobody can hear you. You don't have a microphone!
What are you doing?
Oh. Does anybody want to win a broken printer?
Throws it on the ground.
I hope it's not broken now.
That's broken.
But we'll give that away, broken or not broken. If you come out, this will be given away for free. You just need to show up and get entered. So do that. Let's get into Photo News Music, which is brought to you by audioblocks.com/go/fro. Can we do some summertime DJ Jazzy Jeff style music without actually using the actual song?
Yeah, yeah.
Unless we get permission.
You ain't getting
it. We're not going to get permission. But let's roll out some summertime jams in 3, 2, 1.
Dance. The music's on.
Can't hear it.
You ruined it.
All right, let's get into
it. It's always awkward in front of a live audience with that.
Well, because they don't realize that we do it. They're
Does
probably
it all
waiting.
In post.
They're probably waiting
Cue
for
the
music.
Well, at least I'm not drunk this time.
Well, that's true.
Oh, good, good, that's good true. One. Let's bring up that memory, Todd.
Best Raw Talk ever. Photo news. We've got photographer Jimmy Chin. He climbed to the top of the One World Trade Center spire. In a new 360-degree video, you follow the Nat Geo photographer from the ground up to take photos of New York City. And in the video, he says, "Whenever you're in New York, it's like going to a mountain range. As a climber, your eye is drawn toward the biggest, most beautiful mountain in the range. And in the Manhattan skyline, that mountain is the World Trade Center." And you can find the video over on the site, along with some helicopter shots of Chin actually climbing the spire. I can only find one actual picture.
Maybe they
though,
haven't
that
published
he
it
took.
Yet, though.
On the New York Times article, there's only one picture of that, and then there's also some that he took, and then there's a couple pictures showing him climbing it that a photographer took outside of a helicopter. So I don't know if he posted them anywhere else or
it's,
what.
It's a cool video, first and foremost.
It's a really cool video. It's actually the only 360-degree video that I like.
Oh, that's right. They did the three. Maybe that was more of why they did it.
It's a little hard to pay attention, though, to see like where I should be looking in the 360-degree video.
I just keep rotating and look for what they're talking about.
And I found myself going back a couple times to like replay certain parts.
But we know that the future of it is sitting in one of our Herman Miller chairs and spinning around with the goggles on and just being able to look around. There's nothing better than that.
Oh, and then his camera wasn't tethered to him. He had no strap.
It was, though. He had a strap on.
There was no strap. There was a strap. You see it coming out. But the strap wasn't tied to anything.
It looked like
the camera, he took it out of the bag, and then there was a loose strap.
Really?
And there was not tied to nothing.
Oh, well, if it fell, it would have just landed on the roof anyway.
You sure about that?
Yeah.
With those winds up there?
Yeah. Remember how windy it was at the top of the Empire State Building?
It was
building?
Crazy windy. Anyway, moving forward, GoPro has introduced GoPro Care. It's their new accidental coverage with the tagline, "You break it, we'll replace it." The coverage can be purchased
That's
for
if they're still in business.
Bucks. $99, which will cover you for 2 years. Now, it covers accidental...
What?
Accidental damage in general, which includes not only damage to your camera, but also mounts and accessories, and offers rapid camera replacement, premium customer support, and expert GoPro consulting. Now, it doesn't cover lost or stolen cameras, though, as expected, and it has to be added within 60 days of your camera's purchase.
And how long? 2 years of coverage for
$99? 2 years for $99. Now, price-wise, it'll cost you $99 for the Hero 4 Black Edition, and $39 for your Session, and $79 for a Hero 4 Silver. So it's not bad for the session, but I don't know if I would pay $100.
So
that's a quarter of the price.
Yeah.
Well, the problem is if we put it on our vehicles, which is what we did in the Grand Canyon, what mount did we use? What were those suction cups?
We used the Joby suction cup mounts,
which
incredible.
They were
amazing. Yeah.
But if we lost the camera, then you're out the $99.
And we used them in the helicopter for the 5 minute portrait.
Oh yeah.
Vibrating helicopter lasted the whole time. Yep. Actually,
the one fell off.
Yeah.
That's because you didn't like. Enough. No, that one just fell off. But I don't know that I would spend the $99. They're so inexpensive, and plus they have a new one coming. I mean, so it's $499.
Hero 5's got to be coming any day now.
I've been reading articles about it.
Yeah.
And GoPro has a huge push. They've been buying a lot of companies to start video editing to have software for video editing. Because they realize that people have all this footage, but if they don't know how to edit video, wait a second.
Like
we have a guide.
Simple software.
What is the link?
Video hyphen editing hyphen guide. There you go.
So
this early in the show?
Thanks for the plug. For me to make money.
Jesus.
All right. I guess we're going to have that on the
table. Freaking money on the table.
Feed Morgan. So they have their goal is to make something, a software that rivals the ease of use of iMovie.
Okay.
GoPro needs something because they haven't done a 360 camera and they haven't put out their drone. They haven't put out the 5 yet.
Why would they waste resources creating an editing program?
Because they think they need to have the editing program in order to be successful. I don't know.
If anything, they should have free instructional stuff on how to edit.
Should
not
we just
have a program, but how to edit GoPro footage?
Well, that's because, yeah, just a program. But see,
I'm sure they have tutorials, though, somewhere. Like
the biggest thing, I think, with any GoPro stuff, and we talked about this, is a lack of coverage.
Yeah.
Because people put it on their head, and they're like, well, I don't have anything to cut to, so it's all jump cuts. So they don't cover a story at all. And that no editing program is going to save your lack of coverage.
Well, I think the key with editing GoPro videos, too, is to mix in not only just GoPro shots,
yeah,
but other type of shots.
Agreed.
I remember when I went to Aruba on that business trip.
Business trip?
Well, it was a business trip to test the GoPro Hero 3
with the
Plus.
Clickbait video,
there
right?
It wasn't clickbait. Put up the thumbnail right now. Play some of that. Just don't play the audio because it got flagged for whatever reason.
I saw
reason.
That. Yeah, copyrighted, yeah.
But Todd edited that video, and that got like 400,000 views in a matter of a couple days. It was because
of
the
thumbnail.
It was part of the video.
It was bootylicious.
She had a bikini on that was pink.
Badonk.
And she was getting out of the water.
But yeah, that was all GoPro footage, and you had a lot of footage.
Yeah.
So it was,
yeah,
I was able to piece them together.
With that video.
It wasn't a ton of stuff. You know Jared, he's lazy. He doesn't like to shoot anything. So it was enough variety. And
it wasn't
just,
like it was only a 30-some second video anyway.
Exactly. It's like 30 seconds.
But I'm saying it wasn't hours of like GoPro random footage.
No, I mean, he might have had an hour
there was,
or two tops.
Well,
oh, that's not
yeah.
Okay.
I did me running down the beach.
You jumping on your bed. I remember that part.
I jumped on my bed.
Anything to have his shirt off and on camera.
Yep. I took it into the snorkeling and chased some fishes around.
Fishies?
Oh, that's right.
Then went into the deep water, the 40-foot deep water, and was like not having it because I felt like every time a wave came by, you float with it, but it felt like it was going to overtake my snorkel, and I had to get. I just swam right back to the boat. I'm like done.
Especially, you look like Eazy-E and Ice Cube in that video with your hair.
It's true. It's true. With the curls.
So with this fine print for the GoPro coverage, the care coverage, they charge an additional claim service fee of $79 if they do replace your camera. So you're initially paying
for half
the camera.
At that point, go buy the newest version. Because your camera's already old, buy the new one
now. See, that's stupid.
And they'll limit it to only two replacements max, which isn't terrible.
But if you're going to come up with a replacement service, you say it's $99 for up to two claims.
Exactly.
Deal with it.
Yeah.
But it's like when Apple does that bullshit. It's $99, and then you do it.
You're
$79.
Yeah.
It's like, what? No.
Terrible.
No.
Yep.
So I would not recommend this.
Yeah, and you can find a link to their GoPro Care page if you are interested with an introductory video of the new service over on the site. And then we've got introducing Regina Wiley. She's a 9-year-old wedding photographer who is now being specifically requested as a second shooter by brides. She's a better photographer than Todd, wedding-wise.
That is not true.
So give me the story.
So Regina first started shooting when she was just 3 years old.
Is she friends with Hawkeye Huey?
I don't think she is, but they should be buddies. What's he, like 9
6?
Is he 6? Oh.
I don't know.
Well, her father upgraded her toy camera when she was 3 to a Canon G9 to help him shoot a mountain bike race for fun. After her dad told her time after time again, automatic means that...
If you fall, I will catch you. Time after time.
He always says automatic means that the camera is making decisions instead of the photographer. She eventually insisted on shooting in manual mode with a DSLR by age 7.
She shoot raw, though.
Dude,
Daddy,
and she,
I don't
want to
shoot
up.
Auto anymore.
Actually, I don't know if she shoots raw. I'm sure she does. But she moved up at age 7 to a Canon 7D with a 70-200mm lens.
There's no reason a kid couldn't
do
that.
That's like half her body weight.
True.
That's a heavy camera. Now, that same year, she came along with her dad on a Trash the Dress shoot, and one of her shots became the face of a think tank advertising campaign. I'm not sure which one, but that's pretty awesome at age 7. Now, fast forward to today.
For sure.
She's now 9 and is her dad's primary second shooter for weddings, where she uses a Fuji XE1 and XT1 and a 35-1.4 and 18F2 lens. And you can find a link to some of her work over on the site. And I have to say, they're really good.
Oh, yeah?
Really good shots. Again, blows Todd out of the water when it comes
to
wedding
photos. Screw you, Steven. We need a second shooter, too, for video.
But
Let me see if she's available.
I do wonder who edits her photos.
Maybe she does.
Oh.
She's
Maybe
capable.
She does. Maybe she does. Who knows? And then we've got Adobe has unveiled a new feature for Lightroom CC 2015.6 and Camera Raw. It's called Guided Upright. Now, the new tool lets you straighten lines in photos to help you manually correct the perspective.
You know I don't need this, right?
You're pretty good with your straight lines. Now, they already have the upright tool, which is actually what we used for the HDR video for the Lightroom 30-30. I used that upright tool to straighten out the vertical lines in that video. That only works, the upright tool, with some images. They say upright works well when there are prominent vertical and horizontal lines, but not all images contain prominent lines, limiting the effectiveness of upright. Now, the new guided upright feature will basically guide the upright tool to help it work more effectively. With guided upright, you simply draw 2 to 4 vertical and horizontal guidelines onto the image, and it does the rest for you, straightening out the image with the upright tool. And you can see a demo video of it in action with the one and only Julianne Cost over on the site.
She's a comedian.
Adobe's finest. Instagram says they have officially began rolling out their new algorithm feed to everyone this week and should reach all users around the world by the end of the month.
Yeah, I still haven't seen it.
But it's hit you, I think, Todd.
I feel like
it's definitely
I've
hit mine,
it, yeah,
for sure.
I feel like I have.
They note on their blog why the change is necessary. They say, on average, people miss 70% of their feeds.
Jared only follows himself, so it doesn't really matter.
First off.
And Noah.
I posted 5 Noah. Photos of the photo shoot with my trainer.
Oh, right.
And I love the comments after a couple.
You posted like 6 in one day, didn't you?
I posted like every hour I posted a new one. Just because.
We've got a meme addressing that.
Oh, all right.
I can only imagine.
I can only imagine which shirtless picture of him they chose.
I can't wait.
I love the comments. Like, there's too many of guys. And the women, our FRO women readers,
sure,
were like, they're like, thank you for posting.
More.
All 3 of them.
And then the guy, you know, I left a comment. I'm like, yeah, when I post a picture, pictures of hot girls, you can then shut up. Like, don't even, bitch, this isn't good. I went out and shot. He so happens to be a ripped guy. So what? He's my trainer. Took some photos.
And you posted on Facebook. What did
Is
you
that
say
what
at the top
now,
line?
Trainers?
Like, if you get offended by people with shirts off.
Is that what you call them now? Trainers? What were you training?
His girlfriend was there too.
That's because he was afraid that you were going to try to hit on him.
Yeah.
That's why.
Right.
So Instagram goes on to say, over the past few months, we brought this new way of ordering posts to a portion of the community, and we found that people are liking photos more, commenting more, and generally engaging with the community in a more active way.
All right, cool.
There's also a little update to Instagram's latest version of the iOS app, 8.2. It's a new feature has now been included, which lets you finally post directly to Instagram from anywhere in iOS. You know, that extension.
Oh, right.
So if like, you're in the camera roll, you can, you can click send it to Instagram. And just a little update.
Still can't do an when they roll out for business, I would pay for it, but they're not going to charge if they do it. The timed upload
coming in the next few months, they say. Yep.
What timed upload?
Oh, I'm sorry. The business profiles, I mean.
Yeah, no, those business. If they give us time, if they allow us to do
scheduling.
People have been tweeting me though the past couple of weeks saying that there's several different apps out there that do it. I don't know if it's.
I don't know how legit.
I didn't check them out.
How Hootsuite works is it sends you a notification that it's time to post,
and that's what Latergram does
too. And you remember that. If you like, Snapchat has those third-party ones, but they'll get you banned from Snapchat, as you were aware of.
I almost got banned from Snapchat.
But luckily, we were out to dinner with a Snapchat guy,
and he hooked me up.
He hooked you up. He didn't actually hook you up. It just happened. No, but he told us. He's like, "Yeah, that will get you blocked."
Yeah, he's like, "Don't do it." I'm like, "Oh, all right." Yeah. Wow. So now I can't post anything from like directly my camera roll or anything like that.
Oh,
yeah, it sucks. Some drone news: a man named Nolan Moore, he's modified his Nintendo Power Glove. To control his drone. This thing's awesome.
Does anybody know what a power glove is? Do you know what a power glove is?
I know what it is. I never had one.
Todd,
my
Wizard,
brothers had
was
one.
It Wizard? The Wizard? What was the movie with...
there was a
with,
movie
with
it.
What's his name? Wonder Years? Fred Savage.
Yeah. Oh.
Fred Savage plays this character, and he gets out to like this Nintendo game competition where they're unveiling a new secret game.
Whoa!
And I think it was Mario 2.
Whoa!
And... this kid is the wizard. Like he's like the 6-year-old kid that plays, and he's beating everybody. And I think it has something to do with the power glove. The problem with the power glove was it always disconnected.
Did it?
And you had to keep your arm like a certain
I mean, this thing
straight.
Was made 30 years ago.
1985.
That's incredible.
1986, somewhere
for
around
that,
there.
You know, that time.
I never had the power glove.
It wasn't a huge, like, success. Like,
no.
It was oh, not but just, cheap.
Well, yeah. You could use it on Rad Racer.
Mm-hmm.
Rad Racer was
I don't know what that is.
You turn Rad Racer is a racing game. So, but anyway, go ahead. He used the power glove.
So he used the power glove, and in a new video, which you guys can see over on the website, you see him maneuvering his Parrot AR 2.0 drone only with hand gestures, which isn't super accurate, by the way. Here's how he did it. He says he gutted the internals from the glove, designed two new circuit boards for it. He added sensors on the fingers and kept the original input controls, reprogramming it for the drone. The gestures include making like a flat palm to having the drone hover. You can point up or point down to make the drone go up or down, and that's really it. There's not much gestures that he can do. It's a cool concept. It's just not really realistic just yet.
I got some sun-bitchy gestures for you, you motherfucker. And I swear to my Lord and Savior, Donald J. Trump, if you catch me out on the campaign trail with your little drones and your power glove, I'll make you my personal puppet, sit, jam my hand up your rectum. Goodbye, Jew.
Speaking of, we got a really cool new product that hopefully we want Tether Tools to send us. Is
oh,
that part
the,
of photo
the
news or you
pad.
Didn't use that?
Tether Tools to send us.
The landing pad.
The landing pad
what
for
landing
the drone.
Pad?
Oh, Richie notified me that they came out yeah. with a landing pad.
Oh,
pop up a picture
did someone
of it.
Send me
it's
that email?
Kinda like this.
I thought I did.
It's kinda
no,
like
I don't think
my
you sent
desk.
Me that.
But it's probably it's bigger
and it has
and
landing.
It's got like a helipad symbol
that's
on it,
funny.
So you can land on it.
So who do you want to ask? What's
that?
Her name?
It's Laura.
Laura,
I
yeah,
I believe it's Laura.
It's your girl.
Yeah, hit up Tether Tools and tell them to send us a
landing
a
pad.
Landing pad for our drones.
That was like the Amazon drone. They said if that actually became a thing, that you would have like a little landing pad, and that's where the drone knows to deliver the package.
It looks awesome.
Wow.
It looks really awesome.
That's weird that Tether yeah. Tools, though, is making something like
it's,
that.
It's the exact same thing. It's probably just something you pop on a tripod, and you're done with it.
Interesting.
Yep.
And then speaking of controlling drones, DJI released a new remote follow focus that lets you control your drone camera's focus and aperture from up to 3 miles away in the air or 100 meters away on the ground. Now, allowing you to
Jared,
do...
Jared, stop trying to feed me jokes.
Somebody has to.
Oh, boy, I wish I could control you from 3 miles away.
So this thing allows you to do cinematic pulls mid-flight. The DJI Focus is limited to the DJI Inspire 1, though, with the X5 or X5R cameras, which is what Richie has, that we filmed a lot of the Nikon D500 review on.
Yeah, yeah.
Since the consumer drones, the DJI drones like the Phantom 3 and 4, they only are limited to infinity focus, so you really can't pull anything. Now, it has a focus wheel with a few buttons and comes paired with the motor drive unit itself, which will fit any standard 15 and 19 millimeter rod-based rig, so you can shoot on the ground like any other follow focus as well, or in the air.
This guy.
Now, the price, though, it's going to cost you $2,000.
Oh, snap.
What?
It's a little pricey, and it's available now, and you can
see... It might be worth it so you can double-check Jared's focus.
You could see a demo video of it in action over on the site. With Richie's, though, we had to literally just touch the screen on the iPad to focus. And I remember it was a real pain in the ass.
Yeah. He kept, pull focus! Pull focus! Touch it! Touch it!
Oh,
touch it!
Did he have two controllers? And
no,
you were...
he was controlling, and then he would tell me, I was standing, he's like, touch it! Touch Jared! Touch his head! Touch the fro! I'm like, all right!
Well, because I couldn't use half the footage because some of it was just out of focus.
Yeah, it was hard. It was... Not as responsive as I thought. I'm just banging at it, and it's
yeah. You know. But then we have the Phantom 3 footage that we shot at the way end, that last course that we shot on, and that was all obviously infinity focus, so it worked out perfectly.
Yeah,
that was
exactly.
in focus. Yeah. And then we've got an extremely rare, unopened U.S. military Leica is up for auction on eBay for a whopping $45,000.
So it's not like 1989 Upper Deck with Ken Griffey Jr. sealed box case, you know?
Not
case.
Exactly. No.
We had a case of that.
Did you?
We had 30. How many boxes?
My brother
were
used
in a case?
To love baseball cards.
So how many packs were in a box?
A ton.
Was it?
It was like
32. Is it 32?
Hold on. You keep talking. I'm going to get somebody on the phone.
On the phone?
Boy. Just
hold on. We're going to call my dad. I'm phoning a friend.
Hello?
He'd know this.
Hold on, I'm at BJ's.
Picking up your carrots.
I'm getting apples for you. I'm getting a pallet.
Hello?
Question, we're on the show, you're on the air.
I'm on the air, wow.
Do you have permission to record them?
Question for you. How many boxes in a case of 1989 Upper Deck are there, and how many packs in a box?
Wow.
Second question. Have you ever pulled an upper decker on anybody?
36 in a box.
No, it was 36.
And I think there's 20 boxes in a...
Yeah. That's what I was thinking. I think it was 20 boxes in a case and 36 packs per box.
Correct.
So was it... So that's eight... Well, how many were in a... Was it nine in a stack? There were four...
How many cards were in a pack?
No. How many stacks...
Welcome to Useless Collectibles Talk.
All right. Well, thanks. I figured I would call you because we had a case of that.
Yeah, we did have a case of that, and we did pull our grippies.
Yeah.
I also have a collection of members-only jackets, if you'd like to see them.
All right. We're going to get back. Todd just said you also have a collection of members-only jackets.
I used to have a collection of members-only jackets, but I'm sitting where I'm sitting because of members-only jackets.
It was, actually, he was a collector of Coogee sweaters, Todd.
Oh, Coogee sweater now.
Yeah, yeah. Sweaters, and I still have some sitting upstairs that are probably approaching 30-plus years of age.
Sell them on eBay.
Actually, I have your Coogee sweaters in my closet. You don't know that.
I know they still exist.
Yeah. All right, we're going to get back to the show. Bye.
I your dad's like a freaking encyclopedia, man.
You should. My grandfather is 96 or something, and you want to ask sports questions?
He knows everything.
You call him
every
up,
scorer.
And he's like, yeah, that was Connie Mack Stadium.
1945, the day was
because they didn't
rainy.
Have Google back then. They had to remember things.
It's true.
Huh?
What?
Now, again, since this is an unopened, sealed brown paper bag, the auction comes complete.
I'll get some hamburgers.
It's cheeseburgers.
Oh, get sorry, it right. I got it wrong.
So the auction comes with an X-ray of the box
to make sure something's actually in it
for basically proof that the camera's inside.
It could have just been shit in a box.
Exactly.
In a bag.
Who would know?
It's enough
for $45,000. You don't want to just buy a random box. So the model itself is a Leica KE7A, which was sold by Leica to the military as a kit in the 80s, which contained the camera itself, a 50 f/2 Elkin lens, a lens hood, the case, a strap, and a cable release. And they say the KE7A was basically an M4 that was specifically produced for the U.S. military. Now, if you're not willing to pay 50 G's for this thing that you can't even see, the seller does mention that they're willing to open the box and inspect the camera if you pay a non-refundable £5,000, since opening it will obviously reduce the value of the listing.
It's not a Star Wars figure. It's not like you take it out of the package and it loses its value.
Exactly.
Maybe it does. I don't know. Pretentious Leica people.
It'll probably be broken like the bobbleheads.
If you're coming to the Allen's Cannonball,
coming up,
I'm planning on bringing a couple of cases of bobbleheads to give out. So go
all
see
broken.
Heidi. Heidi will be. Heidi is the only. So Noah won't be there. So Heidi's going to run the merch.
Can't wait. Phone call.
Yes, hello there, assholes. Just wanted to let you know I'm not coming to hawk your bullshit anymore. I've got way more important things to do than hang out with camera nerds. So go screw yourself. Goodbye.
So we've got a new Kickstarter. They're claiming to have made the world's first universal camera. It's called the Mercury camera. The modular camera will allow you to swap between large format 4x5 to Instax film to instant film to digital full frame to medium format and a ton more. The campaign notes that it's an open camera system. They say, what if you could shoot old Polaroid film, Fuji's current Instax version, huge medium format negatives, large sheet film, and digital all with the same camera? What if that camera could take any of the hundreds of amazing professional lenses that have been produced over the past century and longer?
You'd get sued.
What if that camera were light, portable, and inexpensive? And what if it could be easily reconfigured and adapted to do just about anything? Welcome to
anything?
The Mercury, they say.
Anything?
Anything. Like I just said, the camera back will let you use various adapters, and the lens kit will let you use nearly any lens you want, they
cool.
say.
Cool. Not autofocus, though.
Not autofocus. The base configuration...
Well, that's fine for Steven.
The base configuration of the Mercury camera is 6x7 medium format, which accepts medium format 120 roll film backs from Grayflex, Mamiya, Horseman, and Mercury, as well as sheet film holders, they say. And if you're interested in getting this modular camera, there's two different models.
Are
they're
you
offering.
Lactating over there?
No, there's... I was looking at Steven's shirt. He has the old TM, and I thought, you know, when we make the new shirts, you know, I get distracted easily.
Yeah.
I just want to make sure I've got the registered trademark on
here.
It's
a whole other show, just me watching Jared.
Just
not
in,
attention.
Just not in the EU.
That's why I don't cut to his angle half the time, because he's just like...
Oh, I saw your shirts at the all. Mall the other day. You saw that picture, Sam.
Oh, we're not even going to talk about that. Todd's you just can't buy the shirt in Eastern No, the European Union. I still think EU.
I want to get my seat wrong. Any damn way I want it. You can be. You can be shipped on the Barbie. Barbie and Ken.
So again, they're offering two different models of this thing. It's a basic Mercury kit that doesn't include a back or lens, just the frame and adapters, or you can get a limited Merc version, they call it, that comes with the full package, a lens, a back, a trigger, everything you'll need to shoot basically right out of the box. And the basic kit will run you $120, and the full camera will cost you $375, which they note is extremely limited to just two models. They only have two working prototype models that they're giving away for this Kickstarter campaign.
We've got two official models. Here's one, and here's the... son of a bitch. Well...
Now, the campaign goal is for $50,000 with three weeks left to go, and they've already raised about $17,000 at the time of this recording. And you can see their full promo video on the site, which really doesn't explain much about the camera. It's just like a cheesy short
film. How much do you pay?
It's $375 for one of their two cameras, I believe it's already sold out.
Yeah.
Or $120 for their basic kit.
So. Okay, I'm not supporting that.
Yeah, again, it doesn't really explain much on their site or on the actual Kickstarter campaign video. It's kind of confusing. Anyway, moving forward, we've got, while demoing a Steadicam rig at the Cine Gear Expo, a $70,000 camera fell to the ground after the Steadicam arm snapped off.
Hey, Jared!
Where was
that
Jared.
At? How was that?
Was it
Jared.
CES or?
No,
hey, Jared!
NAB.
Look at this! Jared!
Look at
hey,
me, Jared!
Jared. Hey, Jared,
that
was NAB.
He just kept chasing me around.
Well, every time we passed the booth, he had like a new rig on or something that he was trying
Jared,
to pitch
look
you.
Look at this. Jared.
Doing like jumping
don't
jacks.
Look him in the eyes. Don't look him in the eyes.
I think we eventually talked to him.
No, we never did.
I did. I went. I was like, I felt bad for him.
You got stuff sent to you, didn't you?
Yeah, I've used it. Yeah.
You got the Steadicam rig. Yeah. Let's see. So again, the $70,000 rig camera fell off him.
Is there footage?
Terrible. There's footage.
It's amazing.
The camera, which was pointed out to be the Arri Alexa XT,
base
model, $70,000, easily configurable to like $100,000.
I hope he had the GoPro insurance.
Oh, God.
He thought he was super funny while he was dancing with that.
So this thing fell to the ground after the presenter extended the arm a little too far while leaning back
and it just,
to showcase the power of the rig.
You can just see it just pops.
The balance just snapped right off.
Right at like the elbow.
It's terrible.
Yep.
And then the anonymous presenter reached out to Petapixel about the incident and stated... that what failed was the turnbuckle. He goes on to say, what happened here in this video wasn't my fault. My movements were not out of the standards of how we move when we're shooting a music video, making fast push-ins.
I like the way you move.
Or fast pull-outs while sorting obstacles and on different rugged terrains. Now you can see the video clip
on
the camera.
I like to move it, move it.
You can see the video clip, though, over on the website. I can't really tell if it actually hits the ground because you see another person on the side try to grab it.
Somebody does like.
And I couldn't tell if it actually hit it or not. But
well,
$70,000.
If I recall, it's got a monitor at the bottom of it, like a little arm at the bottom of it. He's got a monitor at the bottom of like so he can look at like this underneath the camera.
Oh,
so if anything, it could have maybe gotten saved by it just hitting the monitor. That whole deal.
Well, it looked like there was like a little crate too that it kind of bounced off of, and then it looked like someone tried to catch it. So you can't really see if it hit the ground.
Those cameras are built. To take some abuse, so hopefully.
Yeah, but not falling 5 feet to the ground. I mean, that's a little rough. It's cool coverage, though.
Yeah.
Nice footage.
Great dance, dude.
And then we've got one more story this week. A camera has found its way into a new $400 toothbrush. It's called the Profix or Profix. The toothbrush.
And it's spelled Profixx.
The toothbrush.
I see what you did there.
It houses.
I wish I could dial in the jokes from 3 miles away.
It houses a 10-megapixel camera for capturing images of your teeth and gums while brushing. The tagline reads, "It's hard to take care of your teeth when you can't see what you're taking care of." I knew this would happen when
Keep
I brought
going.
Up this story.
Keep going.
Dirty minds.
No, I was thinking of inside joke for you.
For me?
Todd knows where I was going with that.
I don't know where. I have no idea what
I don't know what you're talking about with that one. Now, paired with an app, it'll let you take photos as well as 1080p video to help you keep track of how your teeth are doing. Now, it's up for pre-order for $300, and you can see the super cheesy commercial over on the website.
We should order one. How much is it?
$400.
We're not
$300.
Ordering. We're not
$300 for pre-order.
No.
What was our toothbrush? Like 150?
$189.
Something
like that.
The best of the
we
best.
We bought the
toothbrush.
Best of the best. I called Steven, like, what's the best toothbrush? You got it for Christmas?
I did a lot of research for that.
Yeah, Steven likes brushing his teeth.
I do.
Oh, that's the one he needs then. He needs the one. So
yeah, you can take pictures of it. All right, is that it?
He can do a YouTube channel. Here's how I brush each tooth 10 times a day before I move on.
Here's how I brush this tooth.
Here's the
Here's
right
how I brush
molar.
My tongue.
45 minutes later.
Steven, can I ask a question?
Yeah.
Do you have a shower playlist that is a certain length of time?
I go through about half an album in the shower. I take about 25-minute showers.
But is it specific every
Yeah, do you have
day?
The same one?
No, I switch it up every time I go in the shower.
All right.
I listen to a different artist and album every time.
Cool. Just checking. Yeah. Okay, so we need some, that's photo nudes. We need some ending photo news music. Should we do
brush
some
teeth
brushing or how this toothbrush will be used music in 3, 2, 1, go.
Did you use this again, Todd?
You know, I was really itching bad back there, and the cream wasn't helping.
What is
bad.
This video clip of that you recorded?
Well, you wanted to see inside my soul.
Oh, God.
So that was brought to you by audioblocks.com/go/fro. Hopefully they like our music choices.
I hope so.
And that's where that came from. That's where I got the music from for my trainer's music when I did the sequence of music that I did.
Was that
Facebook?
Like sexy time music? I didn't actually listen to
it. I just looked up like beats. I didn't have Furno over here to whip it together for me, so I just did it myself. I went like rap beats, and it came up, and I was like...
That's how it went?
Yeah, basically.
Sounds great.
It was 5 bars or so.
Did you cut to the music?
I let it go.
Were you distracted by how like hot he was?
Okay, so... Right now, we get into the interview part now, right?
Yeah.
So we have Alex here. She's going to get into Steven's chair, and we are going to do this interview. And it
smells like farts.
What?
So
as I
said at the very beginning of the show, Alex is looking to figure out a direction to go with YouTube videos, whether to go with Instagram. We end up talking about Snapchat pretty heavily.
But oh my
God. This
yeah, apparently the youth doesn't go on Facebook anymore.
Well,
too.
They don't. But this is a great opportunity for you guys to listen to some straight up marketing, branding, content building advice that you may be able to put into action for yourself. Now, you'll find out that she has a better opportunity because of some skill sets that she's been using for a long time. So that definitely puts her ahead of everybody. But let's get to the interview right now. All right, Alex, welcome.
Thanks for having me.
No problem. So to lead people into where we met through Dave Leno.
Yes.
It was like 2 weeks ago.
About, yeah.
What were you doing there?
Well, I am a film and television major at Boston University, so I was basically shadowing him because I'm not exactly sure what I want to do, whether it's in front of the camera or behind the camera. And so I was kind of going to shadow and just see how things work with production, and also if you're being in front of the camera, your everyday production.
How that all works.
Yeah.
What'd you think? Because to tell you guys out there, it was a Philadelphia Union game, so the soccer game. And what Dave does there is he does pregame and halftime. So it's not in-game commentary, but it's really cool halftime stuff where Dave goes nuts. I mean, we've had Dave on the shows. You guys can check out those. But what did you learn anything? What'd you take out of it?
For my whole life, my dad is a television producer, so I've just followed him in the television trucks and behind the scenes, and I've always been behind the camera. So getting to shadow someone who was in front of the camera was a lot different. I kind of learned that you need to prepare extremely well for sports, specifically knowing the players, having your notes, having extra notes just in case something happens on the fly. And so they were doing a lot of pre-prep, and once they got in front of the camera, it all kind of came together.
Well, you play soccer.
Yes.
So you know sports. Do you know most sports pretty well?
Yeah.
So that gives you a leg up, because there's a lot of people that you can't get into a field where you can't fake it.
Right.
People will know you're faking it in front of the camera. So yeah. Basically, you grew up around the Flyers, I'm assuming?
Yes.
And so you know how that production works.
Yeah.
Which is pretty darn cool. So what is your main goal? Like, what are you looking for me? Because I know we talked about it a little bit, that you said you were interested in YouTube and Instagram. Yeah. And I'm like, well, why don't we just do a brain dump for everybody so this can help maybe trigger something in somebody's mind?
I think for me, most recently, just being in college, I've had some free time during the summer to think about where I want to go with my career. And I've done newsreels at school for my broadcasting show. But I've kind of been like, I love doing the professional side of it, but I also have grown up making my own videos, embarrassing music videos, and just things like that. And so I've kind of wanted to transform that. And I've thought about making a YouTube channel, and I've had some traction on my Instagram with just pictures. And I've kind of wanted to take all of that and transform it into something bigger. And I met you, and you obviously have a very successful YouTube channel. And I've just kind of wanted to pick your brain about how it all came about and how it's working.
Right. So the first thing I looked at, well, one, knowing that you edit your own video, right?
Yeah.
And you can shoot your own video.
Yes.
Puts you at a major advantage over almost everybody out there.
Yeah.
Because the advantage is that because you know how to do this stuff, you don't have to rely on somebody outside to get your work done. You can come up with an idea, you can shoot it, you can produce it, you can edit it, and you can get it out into the world.
Right.
And that, knowing, having that skill set is tremendous. That gives you a great leg up, a great start. Plus, you're probably pretty good in front of the camera because you grew up around it.
Yeah.
That's good. You know what? We'll talk about what type of videos you want to make, but I looked at your Instagram and you're like, I want to get more traction on my Instagram.
Yeah.
Was that something because people were sending you clothes or something?
Yeah, people started to reach out to me and are offering to send me free clothes if I'm willing to post and give them a shout out, which was cool for me because I love fashion and I'm like, yeah, sure, free clothes, why not? But I just wanted to take it to another level because I know people get paid to post and I know people get paid to wear clothes and I'm like, oh, that sounds awesome. How do you get to that point, you know?
Right. So the main thing to remember is that free only takes you so far.
Yes.
That's why they'll try to throw stuff at you all the time.
Right.
Those are free plugs. That's good for them. The mentality that I think is important is to just create the content, not in the hopes that you can sell advertising to it. Mm-hmm. Because early on with YouTube, you don't want to put the ads on right away. Mm-hmm. In my opinion, the ads aren't where you're going to make your money. It's brand and product placements. The makeup companies, like if you're making videos for tweens, you're going to get people that want you to do like showcase their makeup or do a giveaway or do a haul or whatever all that stuff is called. Because I don't find myself watching too many of the Michelle fan videos. No, no, I don't really watch. Well, I mean, I do watch Todd Knows This Cimarelli every once in a while just because I hate it so much. Do you know what that is?
No.
Good. Don't watch it. Don't look up Cimarelli. It's like seven sisters that sing. It's really
interesting. Oh, that
sounds great. Yeah. The key is to just come up with the ideas that you want to create, which we'll talk about in a minute. You basically answered the question before I asked it was, do you want to make this a business?
Yeah.
And I guess that is a direction you want to go. So you have your YouTube opportunity. Do you possibly want to be in the corporate sports world, like a Sportsnet type thing?
I guess it's kind of also what I'm trying to figure out right now. I have, like I said, I'm at school and people are putting me in front of the camera and I'm doing newsreels with sports and everything. And I love sports. It's what I know. I think I'd pick that over news, or I mean, I could do fashion, like e-news is cool, but I want to do sports or fashion, and I just kind of don't know if I should be doing it in, like you said, the corporate world, or could YouTube take me in a different direction.
And so with that, there's people like iJustine, who started almost 10 years ago with what she's done, and she's transitioned very well into, she built the brand. And then she goes and does game coverage at like E3, or all these companies want to have her as a spokesperson because she's a good looking girl who knows how to be in front of the camera, and people follow her. So I personally like being in control of my own destiny, you know, not working for other people. But it may lead to a place where they hire you to go and do stuff, but you're not there full time doing the same thing day in and day out. But when we talked about Instagram, I took a look at the Instagram to see why it's not growing quicker.
Yeah.
And it was simple. At least the basics of it were simple to me. One, you weren't asking any questions of the people watching.
Yeah.
It was just saying something. But there were no hashtags, and so you weren't hashtagging things, and you weren't tagging anybody. So like if you had the watch that you're wearing and you want to tag them in it, Right. Or you ask what. So if you take a picture of your watch, hey guys, check out what I just got, and you tag them, and then you say something along the lines of, what is your favorite watch? Just say an open-ended question, but it creates a conversation. Right. Or take, you know, tag a picture of your watch with something, you know, your Instagram, so that you can go back and look at it. Right. So it's part of riding the hashtag that way. Anything that you're doing, you put a you hashtag it. Okay. And you look for hashtags that are trending or that are interesting that people will find, and then it starts to get out there and turn around. Because if you just like, hey guys, I went and did this today. That's your Snapchat if you did Snapchat.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
That, do you have a Snapchat as well?
Yeah, it's horrible.
But so Snapchat is another way to interact with people. Yeah. I personally, we have this discussion as a team all the time, that what is the value of Snapchat? There's value there. Mm-hmm. There is some value. And then on the other side, I sit there and say, well, if I'm going to spit out 3 minutes of content on a Snapchat, why didn't I just make a video in the first place and put that on Facebook video or put that on YouTube? Because then that content actually lives on. Mm-hmm. Not saying that there is value in content that disappears in 24 hours because somebody has to interact with it pretty quickly.
Right.
So with the Instagram, I would get you would have a lot of pictures. And it seems like for you, it's going to be more about pictures of you.
Yeah.
More so than going and taking pictures of other things.
Right.
And I think that the readers will, depending on which readers are there, will interact with that. And it depends on what you're looking for. But mm-hmm. if it's the tween, like, are you after the tweens?
I think that's, it would be the most relevant to them.
So yeah. Lay out what in your mind the content you would make on a YouTube channel.
So I thought about this a lot because, like I said, when I was younger, I was making music videos, which is not what I want to do anymore. So I think most recently I've realized that I've come of age where I have a lot of information that younger girls would be really excited to know. I remember when I was younger, I'd be like, okay, so what do I wear to this event? Or like, how do I do my makeup with that ugly wing eyeliner thing? And so I'd go on YouTube, and it wasn't embarrassing because no one knows that I'm looking this up. And I'd watch the tutorial and I'd learn how to do it. And I'd show up to the party and everyone would be like, oh my God, you look great. So that was kind of where I connected. Now I'm that girl that can give all of these younger girls ideas. So I think I have a couple different things. I love makeup and fashion. So I think giving girls makeup tutorials, giving girls an idea of places to shop for different things. I know I'm in college, so the bar scene is huge, or the clubs, but then also going on dates, what do you wear? And I've got a pretty good idea of inexpensive places to shop, expensive places that you can shop and put some outfits there. So just like all combined, I think fashion, makeup, and then also just advice. I've gone through a lot with boys and drama and college and high school that I look back on that I wish I could change. And so I think giving feedback to the younger girls who wouldn't want to know that, I would have loved to know the things that I know now, you know? So sure. Just giving them some insight.
So the first step will be, in my opinion, to come up with, you know, an outline of what days you're going to do what on.
Right.
The key to this is once you start, you don't stop. Mm-hmm. And it's not putting out one piece of content every week. Mm-hmm. In my opinion, it's putting out a lot of content. Because starting out, you know, I thought I was late to the game when I got into YouTube because there were people that were already successful. Mm-hmm. And this is even later, but that doesn't mean that it's not something that can grow. And it takes a lot of work. It takes a lot of focus. But the content that you talk about with questions, answering questions for people, they submit questions in the comments. It's super easy to turn that into a video.
Right.
Because you don't have to think really about it. You pick the question, the three questions you want to answer, and you do Alex's three questions or whatever you want to call it, ask Alex anything or mm-hmm. or whatever. And that becomes a series that you do weekly. Or if a cool question comes in and you just want to answer it because it's the proper timing, then you go ahead and you put it out. That's something that you do to engage people. But then the other end of the business comes into, how do you pick a good title and how do you pick a good headline? And so you want to ride the pop culture stuff that goes on. Mm-hmm. Like if something big happens in the fashion industry and somebody's looking that up, or how to do makeup like so-and-so, mm-hmm. you know, how to do the makeup of this girl in the Olympics, you know, something like that. I mean, not really the soccer players. They do wear some makeup, right? Eyeliner.
Yeah.
I remember reffing girls hockey. They always came to the face-off dot with eyeliner. I'm like,
no.
You know, eyeliner.
No makeup for sports.
Well, so the what the kids, MTV Awards, I don't even know because I'm not that age anymore, but things that these kids would be watching that they would search for.
Right.
How so-and-so does her makeup, Jennifer Lawrence. How Jennifer Lawrence does her hair. Yeah. And you just make videos about that stuff. Mm-hmm. And that's how you start to build traction. And then in the videos, you always ask, you know, like this if you like it, which I don't really do a lot of, like, hey, you guys watching out there? You like this video? Give it a thumbs up, right? Meow. Go ahead, press that thumb button. Do it. You know, you ask for things like, hey, do you love this stuff? Well, subscribe here for more information.
Yeah.
And then you, on a channel video, I know I just start to spit a lot of information, but at the beginning of the channel, when they reach there, you talk about, oh, on Mondays I do this, on Wednesdays this happens, on Fridays this happens, and you try to create a schedule for these kids that when they come home from school. So you have to time your videos a certain way because the kids are coming, and you can pre-time them on YouTube. Okay. So if they get home at 4 o'clock, also people are all around the world, so it's not always easy to figure that out. But you do some tests to see where the videos are more popular or when. So a lot of it is, I would pick three staples. You know that the questions are easy for you to answer. You sit in front of your camera because you set up something in your dorm. It looks cool. It's your dorm. Mm-hmm. You put stuff on the wall, little notes to people, whatever, little shout outs. And you just start talking.
Yeah.
And you can't worry about the numbers. I would not put on ads at all at the beginning. I would leave them off and make sure on your page you have a contact so people could either ask questions or business contacts. Mm-hmm. But I wouldn't look at it so much as how to make money now.
Right.
It's about giving so much that over time, then you're able to offer something. Okay. And I think what's going to happen is there's a lot of channels, like even Michelle Phan, she's got her whole network. There's MCNs that are going to try to sign you and come after you and say that they can help you and do all this stuff. They may be able to. I wouldn't sign on with anybody right away. Okay. I would just keep making content, keep your head down, collaborations. Mm-hmm. So if you know other people in the industry, with not the hugest, most large channels, that's harder to get to them. Right. But if you have other people with smaller ones, you give them a shout out, they give you a shout out. But that's if you want to work with them, if you like what they're doing.
Okay. That was very helpful. I was going to ask you, when you're making YouTube channels, obviously people are making similar videos with similar content. And like, what's something that you would kind of advise me to do to stand out and make your video unique compared to others?
Well, I say stand on your own merits.
Okay.
You know, don't copy what everybody else does just because it may work for them. It may not work for you. Be who you are and just share your thoughts with everybody.
Okay.
That's really it is. It's just be authentic. Mm-hmm. If they think you're authentic because you are authentic, then they may watch more.
Right.
And if your videos are just good, you know, I still look at quality content as being a main point of being successful. So you can look at what other people do and you could be like, you know what? I like what they did here, but I could do it in this sort of a way.
Okay.
It's finding your own voice that is different from others. Mm-hmm. Because there are a lot of people doing it, but if you tag it right and you interact properly, because a lot of it is interacting in the comments and talking to people, making them feel like they're a part of what you're doing, means that you're turning them from a fan into a friend. And when you have a friend, you have them for life. They're going to stick around. Hopefully as you grow, they grow. So it's not the easiest answer though, to say what to do there. You just have to try a bunch of different things, but I would be authentic, be your authentic self, and see what works.
So when you obviously started, you didn't have followers. And so is there something specific that you did or you advise people to do in order to gain followers? Or is there like a method or a strategy?
It's all over the board. What works for me may not work for you and may not work for somebody else, because there's all different types. For me, it was continuous, constant content. Mm-hmm. I wanted to flood YouTube with everything photo related so that when somebody did a search, my video was going to pop up no matter what.
Yeah.
Now, over time, we're 6 years in. Sometimes the subscriber numbers don't trend as high each day, but we're working on some things as we move forward to turn that back around to even going higher, because we didn't do any advertising at all when we started.
Mm-hmm.
So I look at it as constant, continuously putting out good quality content, interacting with people, answering their questions, and then seeing what works. Because what you may set out to do today may not work. It may, like, when I started, I know Ferno, who's hanging out over there, asked me a question earlier. He goes, you know, how did you start it? And one of the reasons was to get more photo jobs. And that didn't work. But what started to happen was people were asking questions. They looked to me for the answers. They weren't looking to hire me, but they were looking to become better at what they did.
Okay.
So then I just transitioned and started to answer all those questions. So you could, hey, guys, what makeup questions do you have? Mm-hmm. What do you wish to know about boys? You know, and you find your voice. There's that girl out there who does basically sex education for teens and whatever, and she gets signed on from like Discovery and all these other awesomeness networks and all that to make shows.
Okay.
So you just get out there to be seen and create content, and you never know where it's going to lead to. But I know when you start putting stuff out, and if it does start to get traction, people come knocking on your door to try to sign you to their networks and things like that. And it's different, I think, in your industry. They could probably help you pretty well,
mm-hmm.
Get connections, but I would field a lot of that. I would be very careful with a lot of it.
Okay.
You know, if it comes, when it comes along. So is this scary?
I think when, well, actually, if I started doing this in high school, I would be more nervous because who's not afraid of people being like, oh my gosh, look, she has a video and she got 4 views. And it's like, oh God. But I think now, I mean, I know the content that I want to put out there is worth something to someone because it would have been to me. And so I'm not afraid of rejection or people not watching it. I want to create it so that, I guess I'm not a perfectionist, but I want it to look good and I want my YouTube channel to be user friendly and I want to be able to post enough, which, like you said, because I know how to edit, I love editing, so that's something that it won't be a problem posting, but I just want it to be something that people are interested in watching, I guess.
So thinking about some statistics that I just saw about Snapchat is that the largest growing demographic in Snapchat is all tweens. It's all 13 to 24,
yeah,
and getting younger because the kids are getting to Snapchat. So for you doing your thing, you use YouTube as a catalyst to get out there. That, and then during that, it's like, hey guys, follow me on Snapchat. And I think for what you do, for the tweens who are consuming your stuff or going to consume it, I think Snapchat is a huge play for you.
Okay.
Because even though it doesn't matter that it disappears, it's you giving personal to, hey guys, I'm going out here, this is what I'm doing. Quick 10-second vignettes, or you make a 10-second one and then you talk about something else. Or you go to the mall or wherever people shop. Like, hey guys, I'm here at so-and-so store and here's this outfit that I just found on the shelf.
Yeah.
You know, and I mixed and matched this and look, it's only $9.99 or something. And so quick stuff like that, and then you ask questions, and then you interact back with Snapchat. Like, hey, I saw your question. It's quick because it's a 10-second response, video response, but that's you personally giving them a response.
Right.
They're gonna love the interaction.
Yeah.
So I think you use YouTube to try to build the following because you don't build followings currently on Snapchat out of nowhere.
Right.
Because if nobody knows that it exists, they can't find it through searches. It just doesn't happen right now.
Yeah.
So I think that is a huge play where you utilize YouTube to then promote the places where you want people to interact. And I think it's not Twitter. Kids are definitely not on Twitter.
No.
Instagram is something you promote too, but that's more of a brand centric front end thing. But Snapchat is something that brands, the cool thing about Snapchat is it doesn't matter if 2,000 people physically look at a chat that you did, like a video or something, that's quantifiable. They watched it. You know they watched it because you have the numbers. Or how many people took a screen grab. So like if you take a picture of what makeup you're using today and you're like, you type on it, you do all the Snapchatty stuff that people like, and you watch how many people take a screen grab of it, or you write something and say, you know, take a screen grab of this just to see how many people do it. Those are quantifiable numbers that you can then go to a sponsor or an advertiser with at some point to say, look, I get 5,000 watches per Snapchat. What is the message you want to get out? And that's $1,000 or something.
Yeah.
You know, that's that. But you use YouTube. That's why you don't put the ads on right now, because I don't know. I'm not a tween, so I don't know if you sit and watch the ads, if they bother you, if you just skip them. If somebody wants you to do an ad, you don't want those pre-rolls.
Yeah.
Unless you're getting millions of views a day, that's when you're going to generate good revenue.
Okay.
Like really good revenue. But the beginning is just building up a following. So riding what's popular out there right now. If something happens in pop culture that these kids are aware of, you make a video of it. And if it doesn't fall on Tuesday when you normally put out that Tuesday video, fuck it. Just put it out.
Okay.
Like seriously, it doesn't, you just get it out there. But yeah. I think Snapchat is a huge play for you.
Okay, yeah, I didn't think about Snapchat. That's smart.
It's the but you direct people there. Hey yeah. guys, don't forget to check out my Snapchat because I'm talking to you personally over there. Okay. You know, it's because that's it. It's like ask questions yeah. and they'll send you questions back. And it'll be like, hey, what do you think of this? And you're like, well, I think this. And then that's a personal interaction. It takes a lot of work and it takes time, but it pays dividends because if you're doing it, then they're going to tell their friends. And then hopefully it spreads from there.
Yeah. What's your starter kit for YouTube? Your camera, your lights?
You
yeah, basically.
In this day and age, it's your phone. You pretty much yeah. have everything.
Right.
But if you want to do better than what other people are doing, the keys to it, in my opinion, you could have the best looking video in the world, but if it sounds like crap, they're not going to be interested
True.
In watching it.
Right.
So microphone is important. Mm-hmm. And then, of course, for makeup and lighting, having a ring light or something like that. Right. I mean, you've been in the production place. I'm yeah. sure there's stuff you can ask the production people that will set you up well beyond what most mm-hmm. people have.
Yeah.
So you have a leg up there. Mm-hmm. But I think that... did you just buy a camera?
I just bought one, yeah.
It's about... when you say starter kit, lights, mm-hmm. camera, action. No. Lights, microphone... the camera and your yeah. editing.
Okay.
If your editing is, I don't know what you do, but do it your way. Mm-hmm. A lot of people do jump cuts. Todd hates jump cuts, but that may work for the tween right. market. Like, I don't know what tween's like. I'm not a tween.
Yeah, I think the jump cuts are big in the tween industry.
But if you come up with something that's different, that's right. unique to you, you test things out.
Yeah.
The cool thing about creating content on YouTube is that if something didn't work in today's video, you can make a new video right then and there and yeah. put another one up.
That's true.
And then just interact in the comments and then be careful about the comments.
Yeah.
Because commenting, not what you say, it's what other people are saying. If the negativity is there, don't let it bother you.
Okay.
I can tell you, I can say that. I mean, it happens. It still bothers me.
You get a lot of negativity, Jared.
I get some negativity. People.
But it's more positive than negative.
It's generally more positive than negative, but okay. we always seem to. I personally gravitate towards the negative comments to say, "Well, why don't you like me? Blah blah blah. You should like me, you know." But so I try not to read the comments too yeah. heavily now.
Yeah, of course.
But has this been helpful?
Yeah, for sure. And there's a lot of things that I wouldn't have thought of to do. And I think just also hearing you tell me, like, post as much as possible, I would sit there and edit for 4 days and be like, this is not perfect. And so just getting it out there, I think, and just starting in general is something that I just need to do and put myself out there and then go from there. It will right. get easier.
So, you know, Steven spends a ton of time on content and editing. When I first started, I would wake up, make a video, edit it crappily, put it out into the world.
Yeah.
Lunch and then do the same thing in the afternoon again, mm-hmm. just make content. So for me, it was a lot of content, but it had to be content that was going to possibly draw in the searches because that's how people are going to find you right off the bat.
Yeah.
And then the collaborations, if there's somebody that has a small channel, like you have a small channel and their people don't know about you, you're using each other to get a following.
Right.
That is what you do. You make a video together or you figure out what they like and you're like, oh, hey, check out my friend who does this.
Right.
And then you try that. But it's literally using them to build a following because it's about awareness. And yeah. once you start to capture the awareness is when it can grow. And so that's for me, it's a lot of content. For other people, they put out less content that just seems to that works for them. But I would pick the three staples, like I said, even if you had more. Mm. Just like, what'd you do today? I'm not saying do a daily vlog, which right. is what a lot of people do, but maybe the kids want that.
Right.
Maybe they want to see where you went, but I think the Snapchat helps with that.
Yeah,
so you're
sure.
driving a lot of your utilized YouTube and drive people towards the Snapchat. Facebook, on the other hand, is I don't think the kids are on Facebook anymore.
No one is.
What are we old? We use Facebook and...
Anyways, so...
Is that what you're trying to say?
No, that's fine.
So I think that's the important stuff.
Yeah,
for and you sure. see what works, but you have to be prepared that once you start, you continue and you don't really stop.
Yeah.
Now, certain things you can do, you can get if you get 300, you get 100 questions in, and you only answer 3 questions in a 5 or 6 minute video. Because I don't know what length works better. Mm. I don't know if it's a 2 minute video or is a 10 minute video. What are kids gonna watch? And I don't believe you hear this a lot that they say that kids don't have an attention span to watch long yeah. videos. I don't buy into that. I think if it's quality, they're gonna sit their ass there and they're gonna watch it.
Yeah.
If you give them a reason to watch it, they're gonna do it. But a lot of it is you're just gonna learn as you go.
Mm-hmm.
And you just figure it out. And that's what you do. Once you start, you don't stop. Oh, I was going to say, if you get 100 questions and you answer three in a 5-minute video, you can, in a couple hour period, pre-make all of those videos.
Yeah.
And they don't have to run in order, because if something else comes up that's more important, you could always cut that into its own video. But that's preloaded content that you don't have to think about, that you can set to go live if you're in class or you're playing game or something, or you just have a time frame like, oh, that's going out on Tuesday. You're like, well, I can preset it on YouTube to go out on Tuesday. I don't even need to be there.
Yeah.
Because you already have that pre-made easy content. And that is why I think you have a much better opportunity, because you're good in front of a camera. You have the skill set to shoot and edit, and you have ideas. Mm-hmm. So that already puts you ahead of a lot of people. Okay. So
thank you so much.
You're welcome.
So helpful. Thank
good.
You.
I try to be helpful. And what I'll say to you guys out there, the same thing applies. This isn't rocket science. You just have an idea for something, and you go out and you take this model and you grow on it. My buddy Matt Beck, who I had this guy on twice. A friend told him about my channel, and he wasn't a photographer. He's a hairdresser. So he has freesaloneducation.com, where he makes free salon related videos.
Oh, wow.
And his videos, quality wise at the beginning, weren't great, but he went out and he basically emulated the type of content that we made. Not photography related, learned from the photo videos, bought the cameras, bought the lighting, and then learned as he went along.
Wow.
And now he should be at close to 100,000 subscribers. He goes flying all over the place to teach. He's not cutting hair as much because he's now creating all this content, which is teaching people. So you never know where it's going to lead you.
Yeah.
But for you, I see it leading to being in front of the camera for a larger audience.
Yeah.
You know, you use this as a catalyst to grow what you want, and so that you can then field the opportunities that come along from the people that are like, oh, we want you to do this red carpet, or we want to do a web series around you. Because the biggest thing today is branded content from these MCNs, these media companies, where they want people that can act or can share their information, and they create these series of, say, like, all right, you love sports, excuse me, but you also do this.
Right.
So they will make a show around you for that. And then you're just creating stuff.
Sounds sick.
And I'm done. That was a brain dump.
Oh, my God. Thank you so much. That was a lot.
That's it for now. All right, guys. We'll be right back. So there you have it. I think that was an awesome interview. What'd you think?
That was a good interview. Very good interview.
Ty, I love listening to you talk about yourself. It's amazing.
Was I talking about myself?
Well, you just talked a lot.
But
you didn't talk about yourself.
It was good
really,
advice. It wasn't good.
Oh, it was great advice. Yeah,
I try.
I don't know why she was sitting there, but it was cool. Yeah.
Well, after we started talking back, she had another question that would have been good to film, but it was like, "What's in your bag? Like the go-to stuff that you need to start." Oh, we did talk about that.
We talked about that in the interview.
But there was some other question after the fact that came up about.
Editing. I think it was about editing. Weren't we talking about that for a little bit?
Right. We were talking about if they say it, show it. Then there was a question about audio, because she's like, I've got a microphone on the camera, but would something else be better?
Oh, yeah.
And I was like, well, we actually have this.
We've got a bunch of these laying around.
It's not dusty or anything. It hasn't been sitting around for a year.
Because we got two of them in.
Yeah.
And I think we only use one of them.
This is the Rode Link Filmmaker wireless audio system. It's pretty much a set it and forget it lavalier.
Plug and play,
yeah. That's an extra microphone that we could use for somebody.
Oh, Joe, you want it? No, you don't get it. We're going to give this to Alex so she can go home with it.
That's a better use
and
of
have,
it for
and
sure.
Have a better microphone than just an on-camera one.
Yeah.
This will make the videos that much better. So
it's huge.
This is valued at, what, $400 or is it $500?
I think it's $400, I want to say. I'm not really sure. It's been a while since we checked the
you
price
hear that?
On that.
It's expensive.
It is.
It's expensive.
Look at that. You get to listen to Jared and not talk about yourself at all, and you get a prize for it.
So anyway, that was a cool interview. I hope you guys enjoyed it. Hashtag liked the interview or something. What?
Hashtag all about me.
Fine. Whatever, but it's not. So anyway, that's
good advice.
That's the interview, damn it.
Yeah.
It was good.
So it's time for Gear of the Week.
Yes. What do we have this week?
We have something, but I was going to show it, but I have to check on the NDA on it for when it's allowed to be shown.
Oh, is it still under NDA?
I think it may be, so I don't want to put it out there and then get yelled at.
Oh, that would not be good.
Remember the time Scott yelled at me? Scott Heath
Scott
at the Canon event. It's not a Canon item. Remember when I was like,
what did you show?
He said, he goes, Jared, they have a printer that you can see into over here. And I'm like, awesome, a clear printer. And I get over there and I'm like, disappointed.
Yeah, but that wasn't under NDA or anything. That was at the Canon Expo.
No, but then
yeah,
he took me
just
a,
talking that, shit that about just you Canon being in front of people. Yeah.
But then he's like, Jared, these people are going to spend $100,000, $300,000, $400,000 buying a printer and you're yelling disappointed. I'm like, but I'm disappointed.
I knew what you meant, but he, I,
but I'm
it looked really bad.
So unfortunately,
with everyone else
unfortunately, I
you.
Can't show you the gear of the week. I'm going to double check to see if it's under NDA.
And it's and not then, Canon, by the way.
It's not Canon. We can show it. It's in a blue box.
It's actually Noah, but he hasn't signed his NDA yet.
That's not true. So, sorry, we don't have another gear of the week to pull.
Oh, well.
Okay, it's Wheel of Fro time. Joe, can you go get the wheel, please? I just keep getting distracted. My neighbors are loud.
Squirrel.
They're super loud. Thank God they're moving.
Are they moving?
Shortly.
Oh.
But they're going to have somebody else.
Well, and we're moving to the factory.
They're just
so
talking today, though, right?
Yeah, usually that first time that we anyway, let's get to the
loud
wheel.
Noises.
Around the wheel we go. Here it is, the Wheel of Fro. On the wheel, we've got audioblocks.com/go/fro. The music you're hearing right now came from audioblocks.com/flow. Audioblocks.com/go/fro.
Music you chose.
And the music that
video.
I picked for the video of Steve Swigart, my trainer, is some boombastic music that I found on Audioblocks. Then we've got Fro. I Shoot Raw shirts, officially supposed to move the entire move the entire shipping department from its current shipping department, my dad's basement, over to the Fro factory, is scheduled for Monday, the day this comes out.
You're starting tomorrow, though, right?
We're packing tomorrow, and then it's getting brought over to the Fro factory on Monday.
What's that, like 10 shelves or something?
There's 10 of those wire shelves. There's a video
it's
of
a lot,
that.
A lot of stuff to move.
So there's stuff to move, but if you want to pick up a shirt, go to store.fronosphoto.com. Noah is going to be the new Heidi.
Can't wait.
I can't wait.
Rode microphones, they plug this week. You see, that's a video mic Rowe. No, mic me is that one up there. That's the one I used. We use this mic right here. This is the Rode Broadcaster mic, and also myrodereel.com. Go vote for it, and don't forget to send your emails in. If you entered the competition, we want to see your stuff, and if it doesn't suck... Because if it sucks, we're not showing it. But if it's really good, we're going to give you some Fro bump.
And I believe the mic me is specifically for the phone, and the micro is for a DSLR.
Yes.
Oh, yeah.
Then we've got Lexar. The Lexar hub is what we use. That's in the back of the videos for most of the things
your
I do
desk.
At my desk.
Love it.
We have the micro SD, the SD, the XQD, the C flash, the
C fast,
compact flash.
Using all Lexar cards today?
NX, yeah, all that stuff that we said. So that's what we use. We've got Fro Prize, whatever. We'll figure that out when it lands
your
on
face.
It. We got Hoya. We've got the Fro video guides. Todd already made it rain, so he can't make it rain anymore.
He's out of money.
But go to over to fronosphoto.com, click on guides. You can
go
see
buy some guides so I can put more money in my gun.
You can see all the guides that we have for sale. That helps support the site and keep us going. Squarespace.com/fro to get your 14-day free trial. But head on over to fronosphoto.com/branding to get a 2.5-hour video guide for free on how to build your online presence.
It's awesome.
Alex should go pick that up.
Yeah, really.
Alex, you should pick that up.
It's free.
It's free. It's 2.5 hours if you have time to spare. Then we've got videoblocks.com/go/fro. Give that a check out to get some B-roll. We use that all the time.
Mm-hmm.
Then if it lands on this one,
oh, can't wait.
Be upset.
He'll be crying.
It's an expensive bag, $199.
Yep.
Well, yeah, but now we have the easy way of shipping it because Noah will do it.
Well, one less bag to bring over to the Fro Factory.
We're not bringing
today.
Them over.
Yeah, there's
we're
only no way I'm not, shipping that, assholes.
We're only bringing a couple over at a time. We've got Rode microphone once again, as we just talked about, my Rode reel. Kessler crane, which it landed on for Bill Manning a couple weeks ago, so he should be getting that. Noah.
Quick release plate, yep.
Did you ship Bill Manning's information over? Bill Man, the guy who won the Kessler Crane thing?
Huh?
Grandpa, did you send the guy the Kessler Crane gift?
Oh my god. So Kessler Crane, go to KesslerCrane.com/fro. Use the code
FRO10
to get 10% off. That quick release plate kicks ass.
It does.
That's what Bill won.
Love it.
And that's what we personally use and can't wait to get that damn jib over to the Fro Factory.
Can't wait.
Can start moving stuff over. Well, no, we can't. It's still dirty over there.
It's still going to be cleaned out and everything.
Yeah, and we still need to
and
do the floors.
And the floors got to be done, right?
Yeah, the floors have to be done.
So you can't move anything over
here. We can't move anything yet.
Can you move the shipping department
stuff? Yes, because that's going into the apartment side.
The finish side.
Where nothing's happening.
Gotcha.
But the air was turned on, and what I told the HVAC guy, I said, send me a picture of the air working. That's what I told him.
But I saw he had those little blower things.
He sent me a video. He's like, I'll put some streamers up there for
you.
That
was funny.
That was the first time the
air
went on.
And you said that's
going
to be a little louder than your air here, right?
It sounds a lot louder. Plus, it's lower ceilings.
Yeah.
So it's a pretty, it blows pretty hard.
Room tone's tough.
So do you.
So we may have to tone down the blower, he said, which we could tone it down. Then we've got spin again. We've got Epson. You'd win it.
Nice. Still haven't changed it.
I'm going to replace it with a Canon printer soon.
I wish we had a printer that we could print that out.
It's weird.
We do have an Epson printer. It's a P600. If it lands on that, you are winning that, somebody.
Awesome.
AdoramaPix.com. Use code PXBKJHD23 to get 23% off all your hardcover photo books.
That's also my social security number.
Get off your off your hardback books, any size, unlimited usage, except for no leather, no leather luxe, or fabric.
Do we have an actual expiration date for that yet? Or is that just
end of June?
All June, okay. Ah, you got your book again.
Well, yeah, I had this made, and the people from the Miracle League got their books, and I got a bunch of emails on how unbelievable they look and how appreciative they are that I gave it to them. So I always say, give the gift of photography, and not only did I donate my time to go shoot, but I gave them the gift of these books, and that's going to be a great memory for the people.
I mean, that'll live on forever, unlike digital pictures that will never be seen again.
Win the FRO guide, the Fronos Photo Guide to editing video, or video editing. I think that's what it's called.
Video editing.
Yeah, that you'll win a free one, and that's coming out of Todd's pay.
God damn it.
Think Tank Photo, we use Think Tank bags, it takes us back to the beginning, but we're not going to spin it yet.
We're going to do memes first.
We're going to do memes first,
like
then spin
week.
It.
Yep.
All right, let's grab the meme-y stuff and come right back.
Yes.
All right, so here we go. We are going to show you the memes. You can send them into where?
Singwheelofro@gmail.com.
These are really cool. We love getting these in. They are fun to play with.
Hardly anybody sings, but...
I said we should have changed it by now, but now...
But that's the email address.
That's the email. It's weird.
And this is a great opportunity for you guys to win some stuff. And today, we're going to pick one of these to spin the wheel, and we'll probably pick somebody else to win a free guide.
Some guides, yep.
All right, so first one...
First one is from Broxy Bear. He's trying to game the system. Oh, he keeps sending it, but he's
submitted a bunch, didn't he?
He's pretty good.
Is he?
He's pretty good.
The Jewish soldier. That's good. Yeah, with a think tank.
Oh my
bag
God,
on.
Jared loves this.
I look great in that J thing.
You look jacked. Totally unrealistic.
No, I'm
That's
really
what
that
saying.
Muscle.
It's definitely Photoshop.
Next one, should I go to? Who's that before I go to it?
The next one is from Jay Arbello. It's your Porsche.
Oh. I was trying to figure out.
Spot.
Well, I was trying to figure out what that
it's
was.
It's a great Photoshop job of that license plate.
Funny thing is, they used a Pennsylvania license plate.
And a handicap spot.
It's not me. I do not park in handicap spots. The only time I will park
you
in a
handicap. You should, because you can't see. Because
you're blind.
Nah, people need it more like Jaleel needs it.
Oh, for sure.
Dude, Jaleel posted a video from New York City.
I saw, yeah.
And he's like, it was like, it's this very disheartening
it wasn't
video.
Handicapped accessible like subways or something?
He couldn't get to Brooklyn through the subway system because there was no handicap accessible subway stops to allow him to get there.
That's crazy.
So he had to take a taxi to Brooklyn.
And that's expensive.
That ain't, that ain't cheap.
Yeah. So that sucks.
Yeah.
That's bullshit. The next one is from Matt J.
what's it say?
It's Emo Noah.
It says, Todd, make fun of me 2,000 or 3,000 more times and I'm going to write an angry poem about you.
And he's got a little teardrop.
But also notice his FRO tattoo on his arm.
Oh, and his neck.
FRO life on his neck.
His neck says FRO life.
With a tear and his hair. Did they add hair to him to make it look emo-y?
I think that's just...
Thing in the background. Yeah. I thought they added the hair.
And it does kind of look like...
All right, who's the next one?
Oh, my God.
The next one is from Jason West, and it says it's called So You're Telling Me There's a Chance.
Oh, that's this is why I always make sure to do my hair for the show, because I get one of these freaking memes every time.
We got this one last week. I had to save that in the cut.
Best one ever.
Oh, that is funny,
though. Oh, my God.
I love how he took out my tooth. Dick.
That's great. Yeah, you just need to get that.
Screw you, Jason West.
Can you take a new picture with your new toothbrush? Who's the next one, Todd?
The next one is from
That's more like
Chris
it.
Adval.
Okay.
Making it rain. Learning to master audio guide coming soon. Bitch.
All right, next.
This is the Froriers. Like the Warriors.
Who
the
did
Froriers.
It?
Walter Duren.
Is that Joe? Joe isn't there.
Wait, is Joe next
to
me?
Oh, that is Joe.
That's Joe.
Joe's next to you, the tall one.
That's so funny.
This is an old photo of me because my hair looks different.
Does it?
Yeah.
I think this was taken when Adam shot this photo of me in New York City.
He looks super pale.
And that's an old photo of Todd, too. Look at those glasses.
Awesome. I love Todd's hair in this.
That looks like the way I used to have my hair, by the way.
Yeah, you're right, yeah.
Joe's picture looks actually... I am almost missed it, but for some reason, everybody looks like a giraffe.
Yeah, he does.
All right, I love Noah's look in this.
Huh?
Looks like he's been using that toothbrush.
Who's the next one?
The next one's from Tom Riley, repping Wilkes-Barre, Pennsylvania. Chronos Photo, Steven knows audio, Todd knows video, and Noah knows nothing. Thank you, kind sir. Shut up, Noah!
Next one.
Right, so the next one is audio. Right.
I'll go to it. You ready?
Yep, go.
There's a helicopter outside. Drone. Yo, straight out of focus. Come on. Check it. Please spin the wheel of FRO for me, cause I'm a working class broke MC, and videography's what I bleed. I need some cheddar to get my camera and lighting gear better. If not, at least I'd love an I Shoot Raw sweater. I'd wear that armor like I'm Shredder. Your guides have guided me through online endeavors and in the field forever. Anyway, yo, I love the show. Peace to Todd, Steven, and FRO. Wu-Tang is for the children, let's go.
Ferno, is that good or bad?
You might as well give up. Now that he...
That was really good.
He's going to just go home and quit now.
Okay, next one. Is the next one audio also or no?
Yes, the next one's audio as well from Simon Watley. That other one was from Javin Romero.
Can you just spin the wheel, please? Thank you.
Wait, that's it. It's just
that's
a,
it.
One more time.
It's just a polite British young
Can you
chap.
Just spin the wheel, please? Thank you.
Thank you.
He's tired of you talking. That's
I like that. And the last one is a GIF.
This one's a GIF.
All right, here we go. From Jeremy Green.
Yep.
Oh my god.
That's a good one.
Todd at the end.
That's actually not Photoshop. Actually, that's weird how that.
That's weird. I remember that episode when I took off my shirt. Yeah. That's an old Raw Talk that they got that screenshot from.
That's funny stuff. All right, so we have all of that. We have to pick somebody for the wheel, and let's who do we want to give? All right,
a lot of good ones.
It's a tough one.
I'm gonna vote for the wheel one. The best one here. It's got to be Steven's haircut.
It's pretty good.
Oh, you're talking about so you're telling me there's a chance.
Oh, dick.
You know what? I'll sign off on that one because anything that makes fun of Steven, I'm up for.
So we'll give that person Jason West the spin of the wheel.
Yeah. Jason West.
I like
Jason
that last
West.
One a lot too, though. That was pretty
the meme.
Solid.
Give the meme a
yes.
The GIF.
He gets a he
Jeremy
gets a,
Green.
Yep.
And they both audio.
I like the rap song too.
The rap song
was good. That was good.
Yeah. So rap song and what about the spin the wheel, please?
Can well, you just I think we spin the wheel, please? Mm. Thank you.
That's a good one too.
So who are we picking as the actual winner?
Jason West is getting this.
Yeah,
okay,
gotcha. Jason West will be the
and then they're
going to
get
the spin and then we'll give a
some guides.
A guide to Jason Romero. For his rap song.
Yeah.
And what about the British bloke?
Well, Jeremy Green for his GIF.
The bloke.
Yeah, definitely the GIF.
And we'll give it to the British guy. All right.
And the British guy.
Let's move on to spinning the wheel.
Oi.
Let's do it.
Okay, spin the wheel for Mr. West.
Let's do it.
Mr. West. Mr.
Wild West. Jim West.
Nope.
No? I like that movie.
Nope.
Like
I
the worst
like that movie
ever.
I like the movie.
It was entertaining, but...
I liked it.
So you're telling me there's a chance.
Can you just spin the wheel, please? Thank you.
Around and around it goes. Where it stops, nobody knows. The wheel of FRO is about to make a stop.
Please fall in the bag.
Hopefully
please
not on my bag.
Please go on the bag. Please go on the bag.
Don't land on my bag. Don't land on my bag. Don't land on my bag. Don't land on my bag. Don't land on my bag.
Please go on the bag.
Yes! Yes! Congratulations, Mr. West. You have won something from Squarespace.
Yes.
Go to squarespace.com/FRO. Use code FRO at checkout to get 10% off all your entire order. So if you sign up for a year, you are going to save 10%. But you get a free trial for 14 days with no credit card needed. Please use my code. It supports us so that we can support you like a bra or something.
Okay.
So here we go. What kind of hashtags did we have this week, Todd?
Oh,
I had the
hashtag all about me.
Oh yeah, That one.
We have hashtag bring Fro to Australia at Road Mics.
Yes.
That one. We definitely need that. Something.
Hashtag so you say there's a chance.
That's true. So you say there's a chance. If you like the interview, there was something for that.
There was a hashtag in there?
Well, yeah, then Todd made fun of me before I even figured
it
out
was
what
all
the
about
hashtag
me.
Would be.
Oh, yeah, it's all about me. Yeah.
Great.
Yeah.
Check out Alex's Instagram.
Hashtag sorry, Alex. It's all about Jared.
So that's up there. Thank you to our live guests in the studio today. We had Furno.
Yes.
We had Alex hanging out. We'll have Furno on another time when he gets back from tour.
For sure.
And hear about his story and all of that good stuff.
And when we get back, we'll talk. We'll make fun of Steven being at Firefly.
Yep.
Yeah.
Can't wait.
Yep. And I'll have newer glasses.
Hopefully it doesn't rain
even
this year.
Worse glasses than that.
Hopefully they don't evacuate Firefly
this
year.
Yeah, Kings of Leon we missed last year because they had to freaking evacuate.
And they're back
this
year. Do you think they get paid twice?
That's a good question, man. I'm sure there's something in the contract.
I bet you they got paid. Maybe they have insurance. Maybe they had the GoPro insurance.
They were the only band that didn't come back and play the next day. And they weren't touring the rest of the week or anything.
You know why.
They had an open schedule.
Yeah, you know why.
Yeah.
So, anything else, Steven, you want to add?
You got Alan's Cannonball coming up.
Yeah, we want to see you at the Cannonball. You won't get to see Steven, but you have your chance to win that printer that's back there.
It's an awesome
and
prize.
A DSLR, and you get to eat tacos, and
sensor
Todd
cleaning.
May be there. You can get your sensor
I'm going to come, and I also, as I looked at who was coming, I saw Joe's interview.
Oh. Well, I don't know if I can be there now.
You won't be able to hear him, but he will be there.
I hope he, you know, Joe, tape your Fisher
Price.
He's
going to have, what's going on?
He's going to have gaff tape on his mouth.
No, he should. We should tape the microphone to his
your
hand.
Mouth.
So anyway, that's going to be it. This you can go to RawTalk. Sorry, fronosphoto.com/RawTalk-186 to get. Ooh, it's 187 next time.
187, yeah.
Well, there's a rap song about that.
There's a Census Fail song about that too.
Enough. Yeah, I'm not even getting into that with you right now.
No 187.
Snoop Dizzle.
I could do it. Anyway, so this is 186. Go download the audio portion. Go download the video portion of the podcast. Go to YouTube, watch it, enjoy it. Go to the
town.
Website, interact. And that's where we're going to leave it. Thank you for watching. Jared Poland, fronosphoto.com. See ya.
Please spin the wheel of Fro for me, cause I'm a working class broke MC, and videography's what I bleed. I need some cheddar to get my camera and lighting gear better. If not, at least I love an I shoot raw sweater. I'd wear that.
Can you just spin the wheel, please? Thank you.